You're watching The Breakfast Club.
Morning, everybody. It's DJ MV Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. We got a special guest in the building.
One of the members of the greatest R&B group of all time, in my opinion.
Yes.
Johnny Gill.
I agree with you. Johnny Gill.
Yeah, I left Jodeci. I came in with a new edition. You know what I'm saying? And
but what made New Edition great was that everybody was able to go on and do more even outside the group.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's not a lot of groups that could say, like, what other group did everybody go and do something?
Wu-Tang.
Yeah.
Wu-Tang.
Everybody had a solo. Everybody.
Who else besides? Yeah. Even Master Killer.
Master Killer. No set date.
Johnny Gill lost a lot of weight. Johnny Gill lost some weight. When I seen Johnny Gill perform in Essence, you was about 50 pounds heavier.
Well, I go up and down. Just depends.
How you lose the weight?
Being on
girl
tour.
Problems. Come on, man.
Stress.
It happens. Stress. Oh, man. I'm trying to tell you, man. It's like, damn.
Now, let me ask you this.
That made me happy.
You really having bad girl problems?
You know, well, my roster is getting pretty strong now, but you know, sometimes,
you got a roster,
you know.
JJ.
Johnny playing, man.
You still got a roster?
Man. Come on, man.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm like, you know, hey, man, I try to keep it tight and right. You know what I'm saying? The rest of them all married and locked down and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
But somebody's got to hold it down, you know, and I take it for the team, you know?
You were one of the first ones in New Edition in a relationship, though, even before you joined the group, because the rest of the guys were single, running around crazy.
Yeah, yeah. So I did. I've been there, done that. Yeah, yeah. You know, that's old, back in the day, you know what I'm saying?
Then.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But now I'm like, I have to hold it down for the guys because they held it down for me when I was, you know, locked down. So, you know. I take one for the team.
Now, Stacey's family was real upset with you.
Why?
They told a website, they said, I'm going to read the quote. It said, Jerry, Stacey Lattisall's brother, my mom don't care about what color Johnny Gill is. If it wasn't for her, he wouldn't be in New Edition, period. She basically got him his first record deal, by the way. Stacey's husband is brown skin too. How they going to put my mother out there like that? Johnny Gill, you still my brother, though. They basically believe they was falsely portrayed in the film.
Well, let me say this, young man. And I'm going to try to be politically correct.
There you
do
go.
This really nice and cool and sweet and make sure we get our point across. If you've never done a movie before, had a movie done on your life, part of the process is they sit down, they talk to you about your journey, your truth, your ups, your downs, your good, your bad, and your uglies. Well, we talked about, because she was a part of my career and getting me started, we dated. What were some of the issues and some of the things that we've gone through, some good stuff, some bad. So that was my truth and that was my story. And nobody gets to govern me to tell me and to talk about my truth and my story.
Mm.
Whether you like it or whether you don't, this had nothing to do with trying to make your mother look bad, make Stacey look bad. We're talking about my journey. This is my story that's going out there to the world. And whether you agree to disagree, and as a young man, you don't know everything that might have taken place. So I hear what you're saying to protect and defend your mom. But, you know, I think at the end of the day, 29 million people know that your sister's still here and alive. And at the end of the day, I would suggest that you probably go somewhere, sit down, and be happy and take your 15 minutes or 5 minutes with that window open, see what you can do with it that might help your sister maybe get her life and her career back on track.
Oh,
damn, Johnny.
Now, well, the sisters come at you for dating, you know, because sisters are mad when they seen it was a white woman. It was a white girl.
Well, Stacey's not white. Stacey's black.
Oh, she's black?
She's black, absolutely.
Yeah. Stacey Lattisall? Envy?
Yeah.
You don't know Stacey Lattisall?
Yeah, she's, she was light. She's really light,
she's,
and a lot of people thought.
She's fair.
Everybody thought that she was.
Well, I Googled the picture.
You know,
like she was so pale. Yeah,
everybody thought that.
I guess
I
was so pale, too.
I guess I always knew her music before I knew what she looked like, so I always just knew she was.
And for the record, her mom's never treated me, disrespected me in any way. But, you know, even with my own mom, even with the record company, the president of the record label, he was just like, you know, that story, that part of the story, he was just saying, you know, he used to call her Heavy Cream, and he was like, yeah, you know, Sandra don't really, you know, like you. Dating Stacey, you know, you're a little too dark. My manager, old manager Bill Underwood, Bill used to call me after they used to laugh about it. They started calling me Darky. Yeah, come on, Darky.
Damn. You wasn't even the darkest member of the group, though.
No, but it was just because they knew about the whole situation with Stacey and I. And yes, Stacey and I, even in the comment that that Luke made about the fact that we were you couldn't tear us apart. We were together. A lot, and they had concerns with us being together and spending too much time and all those things, but that was just a part of growing up and a part of the journey and a part of our, you know, what we went through. So that was just my story. It had nothing to do with trying to make her look bad or anyone, but this is just my truth.
And that was back in the day when they wanted y'all to be single to appeal to the fans,
to the
right?
fans and
yeah.
stuff.
Although
yeah.
a celebrity relationship is good too.
Right. Well, absolutely. But you got to understand, I was on top of my game before I was even a celebrity because I was dating her before I was a celebrity.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So, you know, I was, you know.
How did you get it? Was you writing or something? Like, huh? Was you writing?
No.
Was you a writer? Like, how was you?
I was singing.
Okay, okay.
You know, singers, we back then, too, we really used to, the athletes now is taking over and mm-hmm. trying to, you know, give us a run for our money. But back in the day, singers, we had first dibs. Yeah. It was like...
No. Now, when Belle Biv DeVoe was up here, they talked about the whole process of sitting in the room and going over your stories and reading the script together.
Yeah.
Were there some discrepancies that you saw in the script?
In the script itself?
Or like ways that other people told the story, and you're like, that's not how that happened. I don't recall that.
Well, I saw recently that they were just saying that they didn't know that, you know, wasn't sure that or wasn't aware that what Ralph was talking about
right.
was going
took
solo.
Place.
Yeah.
But I remember distinctively, I was there when the first day when we got into the whole shouting match and all that stuff. Ralph and I wind up, and it was so funny because we wound up talking like every day. Once we was finished from recording, we would go and sit down in either his room. Remember when we was sitting there and just talking? And I remember when Ralph told me about the fact that he had all the things, the way he was being treated, and he was talking about the sacrifices that he had made with the fact that they was asking him to go solo a long time ago. And he was like, everything was about, you know, what are the guys going to do? Mm-hmm. What are the guys going to do? So the thing that you got to understand when you're an artist, and Ralph was the lead singer, mm-hmm. Not being able to be free at some point creatively to do some things, and you have to stay in this, you know, this bubble and right. certain things because they had a sound, they had a, you know, a style, you know, so I think that was more frustrating for him more than anything. But, you know, I mean, I know we discussed it and we talked about it back then. So I was, you know, maybe they didn't, I don't know, but I was aware of it.
And
totally
you and Bobby
aware.
Brown never fought?
I don't know where this thing came about with Bobby. The craziest thing about Bob was, Bobby told me, he was like, man, I was so jealous of you, envious and jealous of you. And then when I got a chance, when I saw you, singing and watching you singing, I kept going, damn, wow. But he said, and I was jealous, but it was like, what could I do? And, you know, and the craziest thing is Bobby used to come over to my crib. He used to stay at my crib when he would come to L.A.
Right.
And it was like, I still kept hearing all this stuff about, oh, they're fighting, and he came and he took Bobby Brown's place, and that they were, you know, and it was the total opposite for us.
But
y'all never had real tension? It seemed like you and Ralph had a little tension, and then you and Bobby had some tension?
Nah, we had, you know, it was getting to know each other. It was mm-hmm. kind of like this standoff thing where you go, mm-hmm. well, yo, what's up with you? What's up with you? But it was never issues with Bob or with Ralph. Even Ralph, that when we got there and started talking, we realized we had so much in common. As a matter of fact.
So that scene, I remember that scene with Ralph and Luke and I forgot who played Ralph in the studio.
Yeah, we're talking. Yeah, yeah, that happened,
right.
And it was so funny because we realized we had so much in common, and that was because he was talking about leaving the group, and he said he'll tell you to this day. He said when you came in and we started bonding, man, he was like, that's what made me stay in this group, because I realized there was somebody in here who understood where I was coming from. Mm.
Maybe it was the fresh blood and not having been there from the beginning and went through the trials and tribulations they all did, to have somebody come in fresh, because sometimes, you know, they all came up together
yeah.
in that group.
So those issues that they had amongst each other, I didn't take sides. What right. I did come in and do, and the security will tell you, the first time I got in this group, and they can call me whatever they want to call me, but I came in and I saw the security guy running around trying to take care of four guys, and it was going to the restaurant or going to a store or going to pick up a girl from the airport to whatever was going on. And I saw these guys and they were tired as I don't know what. And they was just trying to handle four guys that was just running crazy. And I said, I saw them being really frustrated, and they were saying, man, and we're getting paid this amount of money and we're doing this work and we're on 24/7. We don't even get to sleep. Mm. So I called a meeting, and I don't think somebody in there liked it very well. But I said, hey, listen, These guys got all of you guys' lives, all of our lives in their hands. And the last thing you want somebody to do that has to protect you to be have a disgruntled worker or right. someone who doesn't want to and want to put themselves or their lives in front of, to protect you. I said, so you got to take care of business. We got to make sure that they're okay and making sure that they're comfortable so that they can look after all of us.
Right.
So it didn't sit well with some in here, but it was about understanding that, hey, man, you got to treat people the way you want them to treat it so that they'll go the extra mile. Because right. it's one thing to go and get a check. It's another thing when someone is really committed because they're happy and they're there and they want to do this for you. So I was just trying to teach them and make them understand that you have to make sure people are okay.
Now, the scene of the movie where it's kind of like they just bought you in the group and Ralph walked in and didn't
Nobody
even know
knew.
That you was a part of the group. Was that real?
That was true.
Wow. The writing session, that was true.
That was true.
Wow.
That was actually true.
That's
because
unfortunately, it worked out because I could see how that would upset.
Oh, absolutely.
Not have any say in who's joining the group or.
I was blindsided. Lewis,
right?
Yeah. Wow. I was blindsided because they told me that I was coming in because they wanted to go back to the five-member group because the choreography looks more, it would be more effective. So I didn't know all the internal stuff that was going on until I got there, and they had already started recording. So I come in, I come in, and Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis is looking, and hey, and then I guess they were like, well, what's really going on? And I remember when everything blew up, and Terry looked at me, and he said, you know, you won't be singing any, doing any leads or anything on this album. And I said, okay. No, just tell me what you guys need me to do.
And that was cool with you. You didn't have a problem with
Never had a problem
was
with it.
Was your contract messed up too, like everybody else?
No, never. And I had a young man by the name of Mr.
I got my bread.
I had a young man by the name of Mr. Bill Underwood. And anybody that knows Mr. Underwood and realized that he was, he didn't play. And I didn't come into this business and had the kind of issues that they had. So, you know, it was a little different for me. And I realized that at some point over time, that what we were able to bring here to the table was something that I think helped everybody. And that was, you know, I had a pretty deep army.
How was that with that struggle? Because they were effed up. So you had to see them getting small checks, and you were cool. You were all right. You had a crib, and
yeah,
they were still going back to the project. So how did they look at you?
That would have bred jealousy, too.
Well, yes, it did. Absolutely, it did. And that's just part of what came with the territory. I didn't create the mess. I just came in here and took care of my business. And I started that from day one. There's a thing that I hear a lot of artists talk about where they performed and they didn't get paid and they went somewhere and somebody took their money or they did all this. And I've never had any of that because from day one, I've always made it clear. And I was just a 15, 16-year-old kid. But I also came up and I had great mentors from Henry Allen and Bill Underwood and the list goes on. There was you can't get me to leave home without half of my money. Right. So I'm not the risk taker. And I realized that early on. So if something is going down and there's no negligence on my end, the reality is that, hey, listen, if it ain't going right, I understand, but right. I can't take the risk and put my money up. That's not what I do. I'm just here. You ask me for my services. I'm coming to render my services if you're going to pay, and we're going to keep it rocking. So I never had that story where it was like, okay, and you get on stage and come off and they don't have more money. It's like, listen, I'm not getting on stage unless my money's in my hands. Right. So it was like, when I hear these stories, I keep going, what did I miss?
Yeah.
Like, really? Like, this is, so many people went through that. But I knew about business and understood business a long time ago. That's why I look at where I'm at today with my own label, all the things that I've been talking to the guys about. I was like, before I put out this last album, this Game Changer, which, by the way, is getting ready to come up on its third year of being out, and we just released our fourth single off there, 3 top tens, 1 number one, mm-hmm. and this is all just me doing for my own, doing it myself. Mm. And I've tried to lead by example, even with my own guys. I'm like, we've been in this business long enough. We got too many relationships. Why are we sitting here with our hands looking like cups asking somebody to give us something? Let's create our own.
Right. Especially right now. The moment is there after the movie.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, and you just try to lead by example. So sometimes I don't think it works for everybody, but I get it. I understand that. And the thing is about us is we all want the same things. If you put us all in separate rooms, we butt heads and go and have internal issues. But if you put us all in a separate room, we all want the same thing for New Edition. And finally having an opportunity to be recognized and be respected, to get our names written in stone, to get our story told. The $100 million question was, what's next?
Right.
What's next?
It seems like the members of New Edition get along just enough to do something, and then y'all go back to not getting along.
Yeah.
And why
that's,
is that?
I don't know, but some kind of way, we always seem to land on our feet. I don't know, I care how you chop it up. It seems like it's just total chaos.
I heard you have a new album, though, a new album. That's
oh, we're, yes. I, immediately, I after a few days after the movie was released, and I called Michael, and we talked, and I said, hey, you know, let's just me and you on here, and let's keep it 100. Some things you don't like about me and some things y'all don't like about you. Let's talk. Let's figure this out.
Michael
What's
Bivins.
Up? Yeah. Okay. And we sat down and we talked. We talked for almost a couple of hours.
Why going is through Michael, some things. Mike, I, by the way, I wanted to play Michael 15 years ago. But why is he the one that everybody seemed to have some type of issue with? Like, he had issues with Ralph.
Yeah. Well, I think Michael realizes that, and I think in some ways I can understand how he feels. When you look at Puffy, when you look at Jay-Z, and you look at Jermaine and all of them, Michael was one of the ones that was at the forefront. And I truly believe that he just feels like he never really got his respect and his just due. And I think anytime somebody's doing something that is not being brought, or it's not him being probably part of doing that and making it happen, it looks like and it gives off still another, I think it's just it just doesn't feel good to him because he wants to be respected. And I understand that. So anything that's coming that looks like it's coming from somewhere else that looked like somebody else is doing it kind of feels almost like, yo, this is my lane. You know, you niggas hold the mic. Y'all sing. This is what I do.
Yeah, they don't mention him in that mogul space, even though Biv 10 was popping.
Yeah, it was popping.
Boys II Men, Another Bad Creation.
And so I understand that it's like it's a part of working hard, and nobody wants to work. As a vocalist, I don't want to go with my work being unnoticed. It's like we all do what we do because we want to be respected. We want our work and people to recognize our work and respect us. So I think that's probably where most of the problem, I think, lies with him, is just that being hands-on and being able to say I was a part of, or I did this, or I created this, was a thing that he was just really driven. And it was driven, I think, simply because he's always wanted and never got the respect that I think that he rightfully deserves.
So what was your problem with each other? Because I've seen y'all perform many a time. So what was that conversation after that?
The craziest thing about us is we could be fighting, throwing chairs and everything in that room. And we get on stage, you would never know there was an issue. And we're on stage laughing and talking, going, come on, old man, pick it up. Let's go.
That's probably the stage is y'all outlet.
Yeah. But I think it's here's what I think our real problem is. And I was just saying this earlier, if you put all of us in a separate room and ask us what do we want for New Edition, we all wanted the same. But everybody, we were so frustrated because we never got the respect and the kind of paper that we thought we deserved.
Right. Don't say respect. Y'all may not have got the paper, but I don't know nobody who don't respect New Edition. But to the point when that New Edition biopic came, we were like, hell yeah.
Yeah. Well,
to get us to watch 3 nights in a row?
Yeah, but you know how long it took? 10 years.
Right.
Yeah.
10 years. Because
I think a lot of people might not have
even
realized it.
Nobody, we went through all the houses. Mm-hmm. Took them 10 years before somebody was able to.
Well, that's their fault because they don't know our culture. Them white people don't know our culture.
Yeah, so, I mean, they were beyond in shock that we had the biggest crowd ever for the induction of the Hollywood, on the Hollywood Walk of Fame just a few weeks ago. And they were actually totally blown away, going, this is the biggest turnout that they've ever had. Yeah.
Wow.
And, you know, but we sometimes didn't even realize, we realized our worth, but because the way that we were being treated or not being treated, we was just all frustrated. So everybody individually went out and became successful and could get things done that sometimes we couldn't get done collectively as New Edition. So people was frustrated and everybody was just fighting amongst each other because we all thought my way is the best way. Right. Your way is the best. My way is the best way.
You
so
what?
That's what the frustration I think came from.
And that's so true, because if you guys are probably getting paid well and compensated properly, it has to be really frustrating to be coming back from tour and it was getting
still,
like a dollar.
Yeah, you know? And you're still looking going, wow.
And then now I got to deal with y'all, tired. We're all working really hard.
Yeah.
We haven't slept.
Yeah.
And we have no money.
Yeah.
That has to be a way that y'all are not going to get along with each other, because your individual lives were probably like,
We were able to do a lot of things really individually that we just, for some reason, just couldn't happen with New Edition for a certain period of time. And you kept sitting there going, wow, like, when are they going to get it? Like, when are we going to really get that level of respect?
Why were you guys so loyal to MCA?
Well, when you're tied in a contract that says I got you for you, I own you, your kids, your grandkids, your mama, there's nothing you can do. And they put themselves in a position, because remember, this happened before I got there. Mm-hmm. that caused them. And this is why it's important to learn how to read. That's why it's important to have and making sure that you understand what's going on with your business and do your homework, because that caused them, I mean, from kids to grown to adults, years of pain of trying to get out of a contract that they got into when they were just little kids.
Mm-hmm. Mm. That should be illegal too.
It should be illegal. Yeah. Yeah. But back then, you know, you could get away with murder pretty much.
Mm-hmm. See, I couldn't tell if, what was the head of the MCA,
Gerald Busby.
I couldn't tell if he like had y'all best interests at heart or he was just trying to play y'all against each other. Cause he'd be with you and be like, just wait till your solo album come out. You're going to do this and be with Ralph. Wait till your solo album come out.
But that seems like trying to play y'all against each other.
No, that was Gerald Busby being what we called a businessman.
Right. Mm.
He understood the value of each individual and when I'm going to keep them all happy, I'm going to lock them in, and I'm going to tell you what you need because I want to keep you all here and have first dibs because this is how I run my business. This is how I'm going to stay in business and stay the president of MCA was to make sure that everybody in here as a group collectively could come together, and then if that meant promising everybody the world individually because he understood the dynamics in the group that people wanted to do things on their own, he was just a great businessman. I love what I think Tank did an incredible job.
Tank did a dope
job.
With Gerald Busby. But you know, Gerald was really one of those kind of guys that was real laid back and slick with his. He was like not the guy that was really aggressive and straightforward. I don't care what you would tell him, he could figure it out. I remember I went to look at a house, in my first house in L.A., and I went to Gerald, and I was telling him he should come take a look at it. He came, took a look at it, and he was like, and I was scared. He was like, no, man, I think you really should buy this house. I mean, this looks like you. I think this is great. You're going to make a lot of money. You're going to be making more records, and you can afford it. And I'm sitting here thinking, I'm like, I'm scared out of my boots thinking, man, is it time to do this? But Gerald was like this real slick guy. And so as time went on and he stopped recording and certain things I didn't want to do that I felt that wasn't working for me, you know, from a creative standpoint. But Gerald was real slick, but he was real tough. You know, he was a tough cookie.
How much was your first house?
I want to say $1.3 million.
$1.3 million?
Wow, that's a lot.
That long ago?
Yeah, $1.3 million.
That's like $3 million.
Yeah, yeah.
Jeez.
And when I got to a place where we butted heads, he was like, you know, no, you want to pay for that house though, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But he was not one of those guys that was really aggressive. Right. He was.
He was like passive aggressive.
Passive aggressive.
Was that New Edition money or that was that my rub you the right way money?
That was actually New Edition money because that was before I actually recorded the my album. Yeah.
Does your top lip flutter right every time you do my mama? Like when you go, put on that
red dress. Well, you know what happens with that? We grown folks in here, but you know.
The ladies, when you got some pussy, you sing, you get down there and sing that?
You know, sometimes, man, you got to do what you got to do.
And you got to hum.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They like that. Like a vibrator.
I talk about even if you sing it verbatim, if you singing along, you got to do that or you really not down. Like you
look up. Did y'all record just like that? Can You Stay in the Rain just like that? You're all in the studio and going verse?
No. We didn't do that, but a lot of the stuff I would sing and then do the ad libs, and then, you know, they would come back in, and whether it was Rick or someone, and they would just go, okay, this is what JG did. So, you know, it didn't matter to me what I had to do when I came in as a group. And I think most importantly for me, if you ever look at most of the pictures, if you ever see us when we're all together, while everybody's jumping in the front, I'm never the guy that's going, hey, look at me.
Right.
Here's my attitude. I don't care who gets the loudest scream because I can't deposit that come Monday in the bank.
There you go. Mm.
So it never bothered me. This is not about getting the most attention for me. It was always about what's the bottom line? Where's the numbers? Who's spending my money? And if they're spending it, make sure that they have to come back here and I need to see what's going on. It's just always been that way for me. And I think that's what has helped me. I went through a period, too, when we got sued and went through all of this stuff and lost everything. I thought, for me, I felt like I would have felt better if I had been on drugs or was doing something crazy so that I can go, okay, yeah, you did something real stupid. But it was just not taking care of my money, not making good choices in doing so.
How did you avoid the drugs? Bobby, my dad, Ricky.
We didn't know Ricky was on drugs. That was my first time. Rick,
it was so bad one time.
Slick Blow?
It was so bad at one point. You know, we had someone with him to try to help him because he struggled and he struggled. But the thing is, he wanted it. He wanted to stop. He wanted out. And I told him, I remember we had a couple of had some conversations and we talked. It's like, hey, man, it's like a kid, a baby learning how to walk. You know, you're going to keep falling, but a baby don't stop. They get right back up. And I said, but having the desire to do so, to want to heal and get better, I said, you just got to keep pushing. And at some point, you're going to be standing up.
I know they offered it to you, though.
Yeah. No one has ever. The craziest thing is I've been around so many people and so many people that I really admire. I've never, to this day, I've never even seen cocaine. I'm 50 years of age. Never seen it. Never seen anyone or no one around me ever use cocaine. But you could see some people's demeanor to recognize something's going on. But never seen it.
I don't think I've ever seen anybody. I've never seen anybody use cocaine either.
Never seen it.
What?
And I often thought, does people look at me when I walk in a room? Because there's so many people.
With the cocaine away.
Yeah, exactly. And that's how I feel. Right. So I often wonder, like, what is it? Because everyone always go, no, you don't want to do that with him. And he's not the one. He's not that. Like, they just, I feel like maybe everyone has always had that level of respect for me and realizing that, like, yeah, oh, here come Reverend Gill, because I don't have no problems going, hey, listen, let me just keep it 100 with you. Let me just be honest with you. Come on, man. You know, come on. You can't do that.
Yeah, I've never seen you either. I've never seen
nobody use cocaine in front of me before
yeah,
either.
Yeah, never. Never.
I've definitely seen cocaine. I didn't fake sniff cocaine before. Like, oh. Knock it off the table. Just let a little bit on the top of your nose. Yeah. Oh, okay.
And, you know, but
tends to sniff cocaine.
I smoked it in a blunt with the weed.
But it's just, it's a blessing, man. Just looking at all of this stuff happening 33 years later, and you go, wow. It's like, it's surreal, man. It's like surreal because this is what we worked hard for. Mm-hmm. This is what we really worked hard for. And it's like watching this happen right in front of us. It's just been beyond incredible.
Was it therapeutic in a way?
Yeah.
Because you see him all open.
Yeah. Yeah.
You do. Like,
absolutely.
You see him, like, out on the free, seemed like.
Well, yeah, because you feel like we finally did it. We finally got to where we needed to go. And at this point, nothing else matters.
Has there been a surge in record sales? Like, what is, I know that there has to be. So
yeah,
what's
that
like?
17, I think it was 17 songs on iTunes. And it's just, it was like just this surge. And it was like, you go, wow. Like, just when you think and thought that, okay, maybe this is as good as it's going to get. And to see all of this take place, it's just like, it is really humbling. But when you're walking, trying to still go through the process and trying to get to where you're going, you're walking and you're kind of, not really on eggshells, but you're just careful how you're walking. And you just, and yeah, it's a bit intense because you're still trying to figure out, how do we get here? Right. How do we get to where we want to be? And it's been a long journey and a long process. And we still got so much more work to do and so much ahead of us. So that's why I put in the call and I sat down with Mike and I said, hey, man, you know, we got babies here that deserves to have an even greater life. And we have an opportunity now at this point to capitalize and continue to grow and take this for what it's worth and do it. And then I had a, you know, after we had that conversation with him, I got on the phone and I talked to Al Haymon. And I tell you, this guy started with us and got us up and running many, many years ago.
Al Haymon. The boxing promoter?
Yes, Al Haymon.
He's not a boxing promoter.
He was in the music before he started. He started from the OJs was one of his first acts. But Al was is just as huge in the music game as he is in boxing today.
Wow.
Oh, he was the man. And to be able to call him and have him to come out of retirement and say, JG, if their heads are right, I'm in. Let's go. And
is everybody's heads right?
Well, everybody seems to be in a good place.
Bobby too?
Bob seemed to be in a good place, but we've talked about the issues and the concerns that we have. We all got on the phone to talk about our concerns with him as our little brother and knowing that what we know he's capable of doing, that we still haven't seen the best of him yet. So he understands that we're gonna move down the road. All of us deserve to make sure our babies and our family are gonna be, you know, taken care of. And Al is one of the most powerful promoters on the planet. Mm-hmm. If he is the most powerful. And he says, I wanna do something for you guys. And I wanna make sure that this time around that you guys get an opportunity to go out here on this road and come back and be really happy and comfortable. And he says, I'm on it, I'm working on it, and I'm going to make sure, he says, I'm going to make you proud.
Will it be 5-12 bus this time?
Six.
Everybody gets
why are you counting Bobby out?
No, I'm sorry. 6-12 bus this time.
I don't know what's going to really happen at the end of the day, but I do know that, you know, at some point, we all got families now, so right. It's not like it's about just having hang on. Yeah.
If you had to share a bus with somebody, who would it be? Let's say they say, oh, we're going to double up 3 buses.
Oh, hands down with Ralph.
Okay.
That's my ride or die. That's my road dog.
Now, does everybody get paid the same?
Oh, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. This is a group that's absolutely everybody. And
why you and Ralph don't do like a Casey and JoJo type of thing? It ain't too late for that either.
Well, I'm getting ready to start working on getting Ralph's album together. Because Ralph never got a chance to nurture his career because he was the lead singer. And every time he wanted to do this before anybody, go out and do some stuff solo. But everybody else beat him to the punch because remember, he was being pulled back and holding him down. So everybody beat him to the punch. And he never really fully got to do. Yeah, and I explained to him, it doesn't matter. You can't chase and try to get yesterday. That's gone. But who you are today, embrace it and let the chips fall where they may. Right. But let's do what you do and enjoy and let people, you have fans that want to see you and want to hear from you.
Yeah,
just
sensitivity
you.
Was popping.
Yeah. So, you know, he's ready to go and I got him in that mindset. So we're just looking at songs and I'm going to release that on my album, on the J Skills
label. And what was the process like with Luke James? Did he follow you? Or?
Now, here's why I was telling Luke how proud I am of him because out of all the actors, we spend the least amount of time around each other only because my mom's been sick, so I've been in D.C. with my mother for the last 6 months. So I wasn't even on the set a lot with them when he was shooting. And I met with him once, and we talked over the phone. Any questions that he had, I would answer. But to watch him embody me and spend not that much time around me was a guy that really did his homework. Mm. And when I was looking at him, I'm just sitting there going, wow. And all my friends said the same thing. Anybody that knows Johnny, that they know that that's who you are. And it's like it was funny to watch this guy be able to, and we know he could sing, but to be able to pick up on my demeanor and be able to embody me and my attitude about how I felt about the business, about life, about them was truly incredible. And I told him, I was like, man, yo, son, you nailed it. You nailed it. Nope. You know, I was concerned because when I did, I was back, like I said, in D.C. with my mother, and I never got a phone call from anyone to say, hey, this movie is about done. We want you to take a look at it and see if there's anything in here that would be, that, you know, you disapprove or might not be uncomfortable or that you might not be happy with. And I never got a phone call from anyone. So I saw the movie the day that everybody else saw.
Wow.
And I kind of felt a certain kind of way because at one point I'm thinking, this is a part of my life too, a part of my life story. And like, nobody's gonna, because of doing what my circumstances is gonna call me and go, hey, let's make sure you can, you know, you take a look at this. And then to get calls and go, hey, we want you to go out and promote the movie. I said, but how am I gonna promote something
I haven't seen?
So that's the reason why you didn't promote the movie.
I'm like, hey, I can't. So I'm keeping my fingers crossed that everything was going to be great. But
looking at your Twitter timeline.
Yeah. I'm just like, man, like, really?
So but you
I'm
were just, happy with it.
I was beyond pleased with it. Leon, please, and I'm grateful, but it was a scary process because I'm sitting there going, wow, nobody's going to call me. I guess, all right, I got it. I see, but, you know, it turned out
wonderful. But some things you wish were in there that didn't make it as far as your story?
Here's my concern. I think the movie turned out incredible. I'm glad. I think it was just enough of who I am, and people got the gist of who Johnny Gill is. So at the end of the day, I'm cool. But I thought at one point, I felt a certain kind of way when they were shooting at one point because I said, wait a minute, they got their girlfriends, they got their brothers, they got their sisters, they got their mamas in here, and I didn't just show up like a genie out of a bottle and just started singing.
Still gonna drop you off.
Like, hey, I had a family too. So, you know, and they were talking about going to D.C. to do so, you know, to film some of the stuff of where I come from and all of that. But unfortunately, I found out later that, you know, due to the budget and they had ran out of money, whatever the case was, I heard was a part of maybe why that got cut out. So, you know, I was a little, you know, disturbed at one point too about that because I'm going, hey, what am I going to tell my mama and my brothers and that, you know, everybody else's family's in the movie but mine's. So, you know, but I never heard from anybody to really, well, they never heard from me to we never talked to really understand what that felt like for me. So I just said, you know what? It's the movie. You guys going to do what y'all going to do. I'll step back.
Well, I'm glad it turned out great.
Yeah, I am too.
And I hope y'all, I can't wait to see y'all tour again.
Absolutely.
Another album.
Yeah.
But you're on tour now.
Yeah, I'm on tour now. Mm-hmm. We just opened last night in Norfolk, Virginia.
I saw that commercial. Was you and some other people?
Fantasia,
Uncle Charlie, and myself. And it's like, man, when soon as the show starts, it just goes, skyrockets, and it never falls down. it's just a night of that's just real entertainment where we just kind of just, everybody comes, bring an A game. But it's like Uncle Charlie, he's close, hitting 60, a little over 60 maybe. Mm-hmm. But he, man, he comes with fire. And then, you know, my baby Fantasia, mm-hmm. Ooh, she brings it, man. So it's just a night of just entertainment where grown folks, you can just come out and, you know, if you don't go home and make some babies, I don't know what's wrong.
Valentine's Day is coming up. where y'all at on Valentine's Day?
We're in Cleveland on Valentine's Day. Yeah, right. Yeah. So, you know, it's a great, incredible
LeBron
show.
LeBron mama will be there. That's Cleveland.
Really?
Yeah, that's a crowd.
Well, we appreciate you joining us.
Man, thanks for having me.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for having me.
It's Johnny Gill. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
Hey, hey, hey. The Breakfast Club. Every weekday morning. Tune in.